Christopher Luxon spent his Labor Day weekend fishing, but it seems he didn't have much luck catching anything, at least not according to social media. A bit like National's coalition negotiations with ACT New Zealand First, where the public is yet to catch how a potential deal is shaping up. Here to maybe shed some light on how it's going, Prime Minister-elect Christopher Luxon joins us this morning. Good morning, welcome in.
Good to be with you, Anna.
You've said you're quite pleased with how these talks are going, but what does that mean?
Well, look, I mean, as I said, I'm not really going to go into great detail because I want to do it differently this time and actually make sure that we're working well with each individual party rather than doing a blow-by-blow with
the
media.
Yes, definitely not asking for details.
Yep, so all I can tell you is that we are doing what we said we would do, progressing the relationships and the arrangements with the respective parties.
Yeah, because
as soon as we've got something to talk about, we will.
The public do want some reassurance that there is some progress being made, I guess.
Absolutely. And, you know, what I said day after the election is that we've got three things to do. One is we do have to wait for those special votes to be counted. That's 3rd of November. Having said that, we're using the time to progress and build the relationships, but also the arrangements with the respective parties. And then thirdly, making sure we get a good transition between the incoming and outgoing governments.
I want to talk about those first two points in a minute, but are you concerned that David Seymour and Winston Peters are not talking to each other at the moment?
No, there's a process to follow and we're working our way through that process. So all I'd just say to you is trust the process. We're going to get to a place where I want strong and stable government on the other side. For me, it's really important that we have goodwill and faith and trust building between the parties.
Have you told them not to talk to each other at the moment?
Again, not getting into any of that. In fairness, because as I said, I want to make sure that, you know...
But you're not ruling it out.
Well, what I'm saying to you is it's really serious stuff that we actually make sure we've got a very strong foundation in place to make sure we've got a stable government for the next 3 to 6 to 9 years.
But do you think they should be talking to each other? I mean, David Seymour's admitted that he's not talking to Winston Peters at the moment. Do you think there should be some kind of relationship?
Again, just not getting into it. There's a process that we're following. The process will work and we'll get strong and stable government on the other side.
Yeah. You have already committed to... Will you, actually, I should say... Rather, commit to working with New Zealand First, even if you don't need them once the special votes have been counted.
Yeah, again, I'm just not going to get into any of the discussion around that because I want to progress the relationship and arrangements with both parties.
But you are already talking to Winston.
Correct. Yep.
So it'd be a bit weird to backtrack on that.
Correct, but I'm just not getting into any of it. And I know that's frustrating for everybody, but it's just that, in fairness, you know, we're obligated under an MMP system to make and go form a strong and stable government. For that to happen, those conversations need to be, you know, as you can imagine, there's lots of things to discuss, understand where everyone's coming from. I want to make sure we've got a strong foundation in place that's got good relationships and good trust at the base of it, and then we can move forward with some pace once we get going.
Why'd you move the talks to Auckland?
It's happened where the number of us live, actually. It's pretty simple, yeah.
You're working from home? Where are you meeting?
No, it doesn't matter. I'm not getting into where we're meeting, but it's obviously a city that a lot of our staff and people are living in, and it's an obvious good place to do it.
Okay. What are you going to do about gangs in your first 100 days?
Yeah, well, look, we've been very clear in the election campaign and in the 18 months before that about gangs, and it's been good to see, for example, the police using some of the powers that have been recently passed, in Opotiki in particular, this week. And again, we want to make sure we get more of those tools to the police so they've got more powers to be able to do that.
So what commitments have you made for the first 100 days?
To get going with the legislation that we promised around tackling gangs, and that means getting that up and running.
So you were quite specific in your 100-day plan?
Correct.
You were going to ban gang patches?
Correct.
Stop.
Give dispersal powers, anti-consorting, yep. Make sure that firearm prohibition orders and also an aggravating factor in sentencing.
How are you going to stop gang offenders from communicating with one another in the first 100 days?
Again, we're going to start drafting that legislation, getting that legislation up and running in that first 100 days so that police can then operationalise that and move it forward. The laws...
You're going to need the support of other parties
sure.
to do that.
Sure.
If you are waiting till the special votes are in, you haven't got 100 days left.
Well, we have 100 days once our government's formed, and that's when we're going to get going. We're going to run Parliament right up until Christmas. We may start Parliament earlier in the new year as well, because that's actually what the rest of New Zealand does. And I think that's important given the agenda that we've got to get moving with. So we've got a lot to do.
How do you practically expect that enforcement to go when it comes to banning gang patches, for example?
Well, look, again, that's going to be up to the police. But I'll just say to you, in Queensland and in Western Australia, where these rules and laws have been passed and been very effective, actually passed by Labor premiers of those respective states, you know, we've seen great success. And so, you know, we'll leave that to police. But it's no different from how we ban...
If that's your rule that you want to bring in, you must have an expectation of how you think it would play out.
Sure, but that's no different from how we ban gang patches, for example, in courtrooms and schools or in hospitals today. It's the same thing, right? It's just an extension of that into public places. Dispersal powers, giving police the powers to break up gangs of intimidating behaviour, anti-consorting powers, and obviously firearm prohibition orders to go after illegal guns.
Have you spoken to Andrew Costa about these plans?
No, not personally, no.
Do you think you should?
Well, no, we're not yet a government. And so the point is that we have a situation in New Zealand where we now have to form a government. Once we form a government, those will be up and running.
Sound them out a bit, because these are plans that you want to bring in.
Yeah, look, I think we've been really clear over the campaign. We launched over 60 different policies. And I think if you're a CE of a government department, you'd be looking at those what we want to propose and what we're going to do.
OK, we had Harry Tam on yesterday. And he talked about pro-social interventions, what else needs to be done. He said that he would consider meeting with you if you were willing to meet with him. Would you meet with Harry Tam?
No interest, really. My message really clearly is if you want to leave a gang, that's good. We encourage you to do that. Life for gang members is going to get harder under a national government. We've been really clear and upfront about that. Gangs are not good. They want all the rights of being Kiwi, not prepared to take the responsibilities, and they peddle a lot of misery across this country in terms of the drug trade.
Do you believe in any pro-social interventions to stop people joining gangs in the first place?
Well, I do. I think, you know, there's a lot that we can do around social investment, which we've talked about, you know, getting to underlying causes and working on that around poverty issues, housing security
and
issues,
education.
And if
Harry wanted to work with you on that, you wouldn't want to work with him?
No, I don't, because actually I actually want to say to people very clearly, gang life is not a good choice, and actually there's nothing good about gang life, you know, in my view. So, I'm talking bluntly about it,
yeah.
But it's important because actually, when we look at the growth of gangs, we look at the growth of violent crime in this country, and we look at what's happening with, you know, meth and drugs, you know, that's the reality of it.
So, I guess that's kind of implying that every gang member is a bad person, right?
No, I'm just saying that gangs are not great. And
so, how do you work out what those pro-social interventions are if you won't talk to them about what they think they need?
Well, I think we all understand we've got a long, ongoing program of making sure that we can actually, through our social investment model, make sure that we're actually helping families and vulnerable folk that might be attracted to that lifestyle with respect to poverty, around housing, around education, all those other options. And we've got to work much harder at that. And that's hard work. It's long-term work. We're going to continue to do that. But on top of that, we are also going to have tougher consequences for it. I'm going to send another message, which is to say, you know, if you're a gang member, leave. You know, that's the best answer.
Right. Prime Minister-elect Luxon, thanks for your time this
morning.
Appreciate
it.